morning, everyone. Thanks for joining. So, as Steve said, my name is Matthew Skipsey, CTO of Giganet, leading the team who are architecting and engineering our UK nationwide network. And on this panel, we're extremely lucky to be joined by some experts in our field, representing ISPs as well as vendors and value-added distribution. And they've been kind enough to enrich us with their knowledge on how technology can set an ISP up for success in this increasing competitive landscape. So we'll start with some quick intros of the panel, please, starting with Barry.
Hey, I'm Barry McGinley. I'm Senior Systems Engineer with EPS Global. EPS are a company out of Dublin. We have 28 global locations, and we have about 500 staff now. It's changing all the time, it's going up the way. So we're 24 years old, and what we've done for the last 10 years is concentrate on open networking. So it's sometimes called disaggregation. Just a small little bit of background on that. This started about 15 years ago. Facebook decided they weren't going to pay Cisco or Juniper for their network gear anymore and decided to design their own switches for their data centers and build their own operating system. So they did that, and all the hyperscale data center guys followed. So Amazon, Google have Sonic in there and build their own hardware as well, or it's OEMs out of Taiwan that build the hardware. And then speed forward then to 2016, and the telecoms industry started to see what was happening in the hyperscale market and wanted some of that. So the telecom infra project was formed, and the ONF had been around for a few years but started concentrating on the telecoms market. So they started working with all the top, AT&T, Verizon, Telefonica, Deutsche Telekom, Orange, and designing hardware that suited, open hardware that suited their networks. So speed forward another 3 or 4 years, and that hardware has become a reality, and we're selling it all over Europe, all over America, and all over Africa at the minute. So that's myself and EPS. So thanks for having me here.
I'm Justin Leese. I'm the Chief Technology and Operations Officer at Oggy. We're an alternative network provider. We're building full fiber networks across South Wales, very proudly Welsh. And we're also vertically integrated, so we provide residential and business services, and we're about to launch wholesale services on our fibre infrastructure on the Welsh Trunk Road network. So we've been going just about 2.5 years now, and sort of very much in the build phase, funded by Infra Capital, so lots of kind of pressure from them, as you heard from the previous panel, not just on premises pass, but now on customers connected and revenues.
Thanks, Matt. Good morning, everybody. I'm Ronan Kelly. I'm Adtran's Chief Technology Officer for the Europe, Middle East, and Africa regions. For anyone that's either new to the industry or has been living under a rock, Adtran equipment shines light down fibers that pass over 8 million households in the UK today. They're the most selected XGS-PON OLT vendor in the UK market at this point in time. And we provide solutions that go from the Wi-Fi devices in your home with a full managed Wi-Fi solution, right through the fiber access networks. And per the commentary earlier from Andrew, I think it was, as there's no such thing as a merger, through the acquisition of ABBA Optical recently, we've now extended our optical portfolio to cover off optical transport, data center interconnect. We have a very, very broad range of carrier Ethernet solutions for those of you on the operator side that are looking to grow your business, grow your ARPUs, and target enterprise customers. We can address that. But also, we've got some extensive fiber monitoring solutions, which are becoming critically important now as governments are applying a lot more scrutiny on operators on how they secure and monitor the networks as they deploy. And then as part of that, as you try and move up the value chain to have your network play a role in the likes of the cellular networks that are being densified across the UK, we also have a timing and synchronization solution that can allow you to partake and offer clocking services as part of that.
Thanks, Ryan. Sam. Thanks. So hi, my name's Sam Defriez. I'm the Director of Networks at YouFibre. So YouFibre are part of the substantial group of companies. We have a sister company in that group called Netomnia that some of you may know. So Netomnia are the access network builder, the FTTH provider, and then YouFibre are the ISP over the top providing the internet service. Netomnia have passed around 500,000 homes now with an ambition to reach 1 million, probably Q1, Q2 next year. And at YouFibre we've connected well over now 35,000 premises or customers, and that's across the 4 countries of the UK. And we've got an ambition to reach around 100,000 in a similar timescale to Netomnia's 1 million homes.
Brilliant, thanks, Sam. So our first question is about consolidation and scrutiny from investors intensifies. What components of an ISP's tech stack are key differentiators to set an organization apart? And how can this be communicated to customers, which is a crucial aspect for that sales and marketing process? So really talking about the technology, about what is differentiating us, you know, I think it's all, we all know that YouFibre is where it's at. You know, what are the other additional technologies now that are in the networks? So Barry, we'll start with yourself, yeah.
Yeah, so obviously the network infrastructure, the hardware is what we'd be focused on. And for the last 2 or 3 years, it's kind of rapid deployment. I know the first speakers kind of weren't talking great about the rapid deployment side of it, but that was pushed by kind of funds and people like that. So we've had, and it's not just like the newer 2, 3, 4 year old altnets. It's guys that have been around for more than a decade. Their things change. They want the 10,000, 20,000, 30, 40, 50,000 homes passed. And obviously newer guys move from 30,000 to 50,000. So getting their hands on hardware became incredibly difficult. And they were getting lead times from, we call them legacy vendors, like Cisco and Juniper, of 12 to 18 months. So we were given quite tight timelines by, as I said, customers we've had for a long time and newer altnets who looked to open networking because they couldn't get the hardware to hit these KPIs. So we managed that, and there's a reason why we were able to manage it, and it's because of disaggregation and open networking. So there's not just one hardware vendor, there's multiple hardware vendors, and they're all using the same Broadcom ASIC. So we're going to give an example of a 100 gig router. And say we go to UFI space and we're looking for it from UFI space, and there's a Cumran 2C chip in it. The software guys have ported to UFI space's box, but they've also ported to all the other hardware vendors' box. So we've got multiple choices on the hardware, and that's what we were able to. We were able to move from company to company to help with these deployments over the last 2 or 3 years. And I suppose on the customer side, so we have a bunch of case studies on the website. Netomi being one of them. A big one in the UK or the US called Metalink, and open networking reduces the TCO as well, so lowers TCO, so we can build networks quicker and we can build them faster without jeopardizing quality. Because as I said, these boxes are in AT&T's network, Telefonica, Deutsche Telekom are using this gear, so there is no, you're not, there is no issue with quality when it comes to them. Not the fiber side of it, the hardware.
Great, thanks, Barry. So Justin, from Augie's perspective, what are you doing within your networks today and thinking about in the future in terms of the technology and how that, you know, transcends and gets down to the customers, you know, and the impact? You know, we've got YouFibre into the home now, but what is differentiating Augie's proposition?
Thanks, Mike. I think for us it's, you know, fundamentally it's about not holding our customers back, whether they're residential customers or business customers. I guess as altnets, we were somewhat fortunate that Clive Selly did us a big favor and faffed around with GFast and long-reach VDSL for some time and didn't build fiber. So that gave us a window of opportunity to have a first mover advantage. But that window of opportunity is closing. You know, love them or hate them, the build machine from Openreach is phenomenal. So, you know, increasingly we're finding that, you know, they're there or not far behind us. So you've kind of got to differentiate yourself now on a few things, really. I think, firstly, it's having the flexibility within your network that you're not holding your customers back. So, you know, we've deployed multi-PON technology with Nokia. That gives us the ability to offer GPON, XGS-PON, and last year we launched 25 GPON in Cardiff. Now, that's not to say that people need those speeds today, but it means that actually when they do have a requirement for that type of bandwidth, we're ready, so we're not going to be holding them back. I think the other thing we've put a lot of focus on is resilience in our network. And you know, I think Ronan's absolutely right. There's a lot more scrutiny now from the regulator and the government around the security and the reliability of the networks. And that's end to end. That's all the way from, you know, your active cabinets in the active net in the access network, all the way through your core network and into your IT systems as well. So, you know, making sure the network is there and the network is secure, I think is very, very important. As I say, it's not just about the network, it's about the back ends as well. I don't know that many of us have a brand resilient enough to suffer what TalkTalk experienced. So focus on that, super important. And then I think great customer service as well off the back of it. So, you know, when you're up against Goliath, you want to be David and you want to have a slingshot and you want to be doing things which enable you to be more nimble and more agile and just do things that the incumbent really can't do. So you know, all the way through the technology stack and all the way through the service wrap, I think it's about being different and being able to do things that delight your customers and wow your customers, and not, you know, it would be a very dangerous place to be to just be me too versus Goliath. And then I think fundamentally from us, sort of away from the technology stack, you know, our focus has been very much on kind of hyper local and being a local brand within Wales. So we're not perceived as the big UK incumbent headquartered in London. We're embedded in the communities that we work with, and we're selling our technology and the benefits of our technology at a hyper-local level.
Great, thanks, Justin. So Ronan, I mean, from a vendor's perspective, you've got great insight into, you know, a huge portion of the UK market, the vast majority of the altnets are using your hardware, and obviously you've got the global presence. What are you seeing in terms of the vendor's perspective and some of the visionary bits coming along to enhance that in-home, perhaps, experience? And to offer that more complete service to consumers and businesses alike, for that matter.
I think the key trend that we're seeing now, if I was to sum it up in one word, the primary focus on the industry at this point in time, not just here in the UK, but across the whole of the developed world now at this point, is scale. You know, I think most operators, those that were unable to prove that they could effectively build a network, well, we've seen the outcome of that already. It was spoken about on the first panel through consolidation. But I think there's general acceptance that most of the operators that are building networks at this point in time can build at a reasonable pace. But now it's about getting subscribers onto those networks, and it's about having very, very efficient systems that allow the dispatch, the enablement, the turn up of those subscribers onto the network, and the automation in the delivery of the services and the equipment that delivers those services for those customers. We've seen there's a reasonably consistent trend now that's starting, particularly as consolidation is a large part of the narrative within the marketplace at this point in time. There's a reasonably consistent trend now that's starting to bubble up to the top. And it's what I describe as the free puppy trap. And what I mean by that is, out of curiosity, who in the audience over the years has received a free puppy at some point along the way, or a free kitten? You know, it's fantastic to get these gifts and bring them home and everybody's all smiling. But when you work out the total cost of ownership over the lifespan of the kitten or the puppy, it's far from free, between feeding it and vet bills and, you know, kennels and all that sort of thing. And we see this quite often where a lot of the challenger operators in the different markets across the developed world, when they first start out, you know, quite often they're starting out with money from friends and family. So every pound counts with regard to how that money is put to use. And quite often they very much focus towards, you know, I want to put every single pound towards connecting customers because that's going to start bringing in revenue and it's going to boost the value of my business, which is fully understandable. But when it comes to things like the automated systems that will allow that business to grow and to scale, quite often they'll look internally and go, oh, do you know what? We don't really want to pay for that. We want to put the money towards connecting customers, so we'll develop our own because it's free. We've got engineering resources. They're very clever. They can develop some really good stuff. And that always proves to be the case. There are lots of really, really clever systems that have been developed out there. But where we're starting to see things creaking out there now at this point is as scale starts to come into the story. A lot of the solutions out there, you know, between churn amongst the staff as people move to different operators, some of the expertise has been lost and people don't know how to grow and scale the systems, but also just fundamental architectural problems with a lot of these solutions. So quite often we're seeing service providers that are turning themselves into vendors. Like I always find it ironic when, you know, you're trying to schedule a meeting with a customer and say, oh, we can't, we have an internal roadmap meeting going on to develop our OSS system. And you're going, I didn't realize you were a vendor. You know, so we've seen a lot of people fall into that free puppy trap. And that's, it's doing two things. First of all, it's limiting their ability to scale as they want to scale the business. So it's serving as something that's holding the business back. But then secondly, for those that are seeking an exit, whether it's through, you know, a distress sale or through, you know, a premium sale within the marketplace, quite often when due diligence is done on the network, but also the systems that run the network, that can significantly impact the valuation of the business as well. So, you know, that's one of the challenges that we see when it comes to the stack. Matt, you mentioned the in-home environment. I think to the point that was made earlier by Justin, you know, that customer satisfaction is the key piece. You know, if customers are not satisfied, they're going to move. We're all customers. We all have broadband connections. We're not happy with what we get. We're going to look elsewhere. If we are happy and we feel we're getting good value for money, that serves as a great protective barrier for churn on your customer base across the network. The key to that, you know, there's no question the fiber networks can deliver more than enough capacity. We're all in the world of twice all you can eat now at this point in time. You know, we've 1 gig, 2 gig, 3 gig services. Very, very few consumers can get close to reaching the capacities that they can afford in their disposable income today. But when it comes to delivering that capacity throughout the home in a reliable fashion to all the facets of the household where people expect to have the coverage, that's where the challenge is. And I think over the last 2 years, the UK operator community have really woken up to that challenge. And many of them have stepped up to provide managed Wi-Fi solutions now as part of the offering that goes with that. And that's key, I think, to ensuring that you've got the satisfied customer base out there. You've got to automate those networks. You can't have people going in and making manual adjustments to the Wi-Fi environment. That doesn't scale. If that's your answer, you're on a non-starter from the get-go. It's got to be fully automated. It's got to be centralized within the clouds. You've got full visibility across not just one customer's home, but all the adjacent customer homes around that, or apartments if it's an apartment block, so you can manage the RF environment much more effectively. So it's really down to, you know, the key piece, I think, Matt, is that automated visibility with a single pane of glass that goes from the Wi-Fi device in the customer's hand right through to the internet peering point in the data center. We call it the door to the core visibility, and you've got to have that on every aspect of the network.
Perfect. No, great, Ronan.
Just to add a little bit to that, at the in-house experience, how important it is. And there are, over the last 2 or 3 years, some really good, so most people in the room will know Plume, and there are other products. And it's not just beneficial to the customer, it's beneficial to the ISP to be able to see what's happening inside the residence as well. So there's really good products out there for ISPs.
Sam, YouFibre have grown pretty fast now, four corners of the UK. What are the technologies that you are using within YouFibre to get that scale fast, and what does that mean for end customers?
Yes, good question. Firstly, I've never had a free puppy from you, Ronan. I'm not sure that happens next Christmas. So I think the Netomnia network is built on an XGS-PON base. It's pure XGS-PON. I think that benefits us immediately. It gives our customers a good experience now, but it'd be more beneficial in years to come as uptake increases and as per customer usage increases. Certainly that will benefit us more than having a Jeep on any network, for instance. But I think it's quite hard to differentiate yourself at the moment just from a network perspective. I think you need to stand apart. You need to do a little bit more. So your back end, you know, how good is your GIS tool? Do you know exactly where your fiber network goes? How easily can you take payments? How good are your customer records? Do you have a layer to provision and automate and onboard customers quick, cleanly and smoothly? Those kind of things are quite big questions now. You know, a lot's been said about the in-home experience. We do an awful lot around in-home in terms of how we install and how we put mesh in and all those kind of things. So I think they've all been spoken about here. There's a huge number of things that you have to do to onboard customers to differentiate yourself from the competition. And I think it's not all just network related. It has to be customer service. It has to be the whole wrap up. Yeah.
Perfect. And what are you doing specifically about in-home experience? You know, quite a lot of the feedback anecdotal is consumers are getting these full fiber connections. The moment of truth happens, they end up being underwhelmed by the experience because, you know, it's not about the full fiber to all corners of the home, the garden, the outbuilding where they built an office in lockdown, whatever it might be. So what are you doing, and perhaps Justin as well, just from your perspective there?
Yeah, so it's a great question, and you can certainly take a solution like a Plume that can do it all for you. You will certainly pay for it, but you can do it. I think the easiest method to get that good Wi-Fi in the home is at the install. That's the key place to do it. So where are you siting that home gateway? If it's a mesh install, where are you putting those mesh nodes? If you just ship it to the customer, let them do it themselves, are you going to guarantee that good level of service? Probably not. So we put a lot of time into ensuring that the install is as good as it can be. I think that's the best place to start, and it's a nice, free and easy place to do it as well. And then it's, as Ronan alluded to, the how do you improve that? How do you work around any issues that might be there? Can you automate that? Can you do that without the customer noticing that you've done it as well? And then if you need to send somebody out, do you have the relevant level of expertise to go out quickly and to fix that problem and work around that issue if there is one there, if you need that truck roll or that customer visit? Yeah.
Great, thanks.
Yeah, so I agree with Sam. I think getting the install right is really, really important. I mean, we use our own in-house install team because we've kind of recognised that's, in many cases, the only person from Oggy that customer's ever going to meet face-to-face. So getting that right is important. It starts the relationship off on a really good footing. But then I think it's the ecosystem then wrapped around the products which you're using in the home. I think Ronan's exactly right. I think it's having the ability to monitor. You know, if you're trying to monitor and manage on an individual device level, that won't scale. So I think having a cloud-based solution, which you can basically look at the entire fleet of CPE that you've got installed, and use some kind of machine learning within that to identify trends and things which are, you know, you want to be managing by exception, not trying to manage hundreds of thousands of devices ultimately. And we've deployed the Amazon Eero solution. And actually, it's got a really nice consumer-facing app which the customer can use, which is very friendly. But then the toolset which our care teams have got, cloud-based toolset, is absolutely phenomenal. So it does give you that very sort of holistic view of what's going on in the network and trending in the network. But actually, if you do need to get down into an individual premise and see what's going on with devices, you can do that as well. And sort of zoom backwards in time and see what happened at 10 o'clock this morning when the problem they had has miraculously gone away, but what happened at 10 o'clock this morning. So I think those tools are really important, and I think it's been a phase shift in the thinking of ISPs over the last couple of years that customers are not buying broadband, they're buying Wi-Fi throughout the home, and whether you like it or not, that's what you're selling. So better gear up to be able to provide support around that in a way that scales cost effectively.
Fantastic, thanks Justin. So the second question is around take up. So more questions have been asked around the take up of many FTTP providers, more focused on gaining customers rather than build. What technologies can networks and ISPs use to, and what are key deciding factors for consumers when they're choosing a provider? So Barry, what are you seeing within your product portfolio
it comes back to the customer experience side of things. So there's quicker builds as well, getting out to areas that are underserved. The in-house experience is what we're hearing is important. So as I said, there's really good products, and it's not just for the consumer, it's for the ISP to have visibility into the networks to stop truck rolls, I suppose. There's a bunch of guys out there doing that. So Bloom, obviously, but then you have DZS and Cloud Check, which they're calling DZS Experience. A range of products which, as I said, benefit the ISP just as much as the customer.
Sam, are you doing anything within YouFibre to increase the ARPU? So effectively, customers are getting fantastic deal, low prices on the actual underlying connectivity, but what are the other things that you're doing to increase the value, lifetime value of that customer with technology?
It's a very good question. So, as you say, the broadband package is the main piece that we sell. I think from there, it's what can you layer onto that. So the first place that we do that is with our voice package. We've got a number of different VoIP packages that we can add on with different types of calling, free of charge to local, national, international, those kind of things. And we let the customer bolt that on as they wish. And then it's the in-home experience that we focus on. So the mesh and do you need additional mesh nodes? Do you need that install led from us with our Wi-Fi expertise? And I think that obviously allows us to increase ARPU. I think the opportunity is there with the in-home experience because it's so important. Customers expect constant uptime and constant access to the speeds that they have purchased. And if you're not providing that, they'll churn very quickly. So I think it's absolutely fundamental to be doing that. So I've already spoken about the install, but Are there other areas that you can focus on with technology? You know, I think Wi-Fi 6 is a very interesting technology that we could look at there. So yes, it's probably going to be transitional. It may only last 2 or 3 years before Wi-Fi 7 becomes commercially viable. But at present, it's here. A lot of the bigger providers are most likely going to skip it and go straight to 7. So there's a chance for a small company like ourselves to move quickly and use that as a way to give customers that extra piece of quality, because, you know, having 6 gigahertz open in the home should give you a better mesh experience than a Wi-Fi 5 or Wi-Fi 6, even tri-band deployment could, especially when you try and deploy tri-band with SkyQ at the same time. So I think the opportunity is there to, you know, possibly consider a premium Wi-Fi offering with that could also increase our ARPU.
Thank you. And Ronan, from your perspective, you know, with Adtran now being on board, you know, what are you seeing to drive that take up in particular of these networks through best use of technology or additional leading technology items?
To be honest, I'd love to say technology is the answer, but I really don't think it is. Mm-hmm. I think the thing that can be most impactful for driving the take up of all the fiber networks that you guys are building out there is awareness amongst consumers as to what's real fiber and what's not. I think we've seen Ofcom start to make some right noises in the right direction with regard to service providers having to properly classify what is a full fiber connection. It's late in the day, but it's better late than never. I think the Advertising Standards Authority still has a job of work to do. They need to wake up and really understand, you know, what's happened in other markets where it's been proven that if you only call a full fiber connection a fiber service, and you don't allow any other type of service to be called a name with fiber in the name of it, then you remove the confusion from the consumers. Because part of the challenge we have is, you know, we're you know, 1, maybe 2% of the population out there that are technically oriented. So a lot of the things that we gravitate towards, whether it's the new version of PON or whether it's a new version of Wi-Fi or whatever, consumers don't get it. They don't want to get it. They just want to walk in the front door and stuff works. They want to turn on a tap and water comes out. They want to plug in a plug and electricity comes out. They want to walk into their home and there's Wi-Fi everywhere. That's what they want. They don't even buy broadband. They buy Wi-Fi. That's what they think they buy. So we've really got to, you know, change the mindset with regard to advertising standards and allow the real value of these fiber networks to shine over and above the alternatives that are not full fiber.
Certainly agree. Justin, how are you dealing with the challenge of apathy out there of, you know, people who are managing fine on VDSL, copper, hybrid fiber services? What are you doing to educate them and to gain that market share?
Yeah, so I mean, I kind of agree with Ronan to a point in that, you know, there definitely has been confusion out there about the difference between full fiber and fake fiber. I think that position is changing. I think the large ISPs now are starting to pump marketing into their full fiber products, and they need to now, they've put themselves in a difficult position that they've now got to explain to their customers why their new fiber is better than their old fiber. So I think that's helping us. But I mean, we definitely do, you know, with our sort of door-to-door sales teams particularly, we do still find lots of people who think they're on a fiber connection and they're not. I do tend to agree. I think it's kind of less of a technology sum. I think if you're rolling out an XGS-PON capable network, it's going to do everything a customer is going to require today. I think what we find is when people realize they're not on full fiber and you get them onto full fiber, the experience from what they've had previously is night and day. And then it's about then just providing good service to them so that they stay with you. But I think they are so blown away by the technology when they get it. And you know, certainly our social media posts we get from our customers are people just going, this is amazing. I think the other thing I'd say is we were quite surprised. We launched a voice product at the same time, expecting it to be not a big seller. We just thought we needed it there as a, you know, so we could say, well, me too. Actually, about a third of our customer base is still taking voice, which was quite surprising. But then, it's a fiver a month for evening weekend calls. So it's, I think a lot of people say, well, there are some people who still call me on my landline and know that number and we'd like to keep it. I think as we move into PSTN switch off, actually that will become a selling point for us to say, actually, you can take broadband from us and you can keep your phone number and we can provide you with a service. So I think that will help with our stickiness. On our B2B services, a lot of our focus has been on being a service provider to businesses, to small businesses in Wales. So it's not just about connection. It's about saying, well, we can take care of your Microsoft licensing for you. We can deal with your firewall. We can do your in-office Wi-Fi services. It's about having and all your business telephony services. And I think having that rich wrap where you say, actually, this isn't just about providing with a really fast connection. It's about enabling your business, because it's otherwise we give you a big fat pipe and you sit there and go, well, what can we do with it? And it's actually, these are all things you can do with it. We can provide you with the applications for you to really take full advantage of that connectivity. So I think it is a blend of kind of the technology and then the service wraps that you put around these things.
Brilliant. Our final question is talking about how we can, you know, use technologies to more efficiently run networks. And for a long time, network automation has been a theme that, you know, all of us have been striving towards. And now we're talking about machine learning and AI to get that bingo in there. You know, how are these technologies, you know, being used to enhance an ISP's network? What's been done today, but what are we thinking about in the future as well? Yeah, Barry, if we start with yourself.
Yeah, so I asked ChatGPT this question. Rubbish, so it's not helping. I suppose coming from the open networking side of things is that obviously orchestration platform. Everyone wants to automate more, but we're not there yet with the telecoms networks because there's so many different devices built over and a lot of them over a long period of time. But I can see where it's going, like the data center kind of market went. So I'm saying the data center market is 15 years old now. And it's kind of can nearly consolidate on an operating system, which is Sonic, and it was Microsoft Azure's operating system. But since that's kind of starting to consolidate, we have open source versions and then we have commercial versions of Sonic. But saying within 5 to 10 years, it will be the de facto operating system for the data center, and it'll be the open source versions, and you'll have basically orchestration platforms sitting above that, which will offer support. So that's the way it's going. We have our own Sonic products, Sonic Express, it's called, from UPS Global, I forgot the name of it. And we have probably 8 or 9 different orchestration platforms for that one specific product from different guys. So it's not a mature area in open networking yet, just because it's a lot of new products, but there is work being done there by a couple of guys, IP Fusion and Adtran are working on it, but yeah, at the minute there's a bit to go from open networking.
Ronan, from your perspective, you've got a handful of large scale operators using your technology,
yep,
who need to do a lot of this to underpin their wholesale offering, the scale.
Yep.
So what are they doing now, and what are they thinking about, and what can we all take from that, and how easy is it for smaller operators to get access into that?
Sure.
Wholesale?
Well, if I work on the assumption of 5 fingers per hand, it's definitely more than a handful. But there's an increasing number of very large scale operators, but equally a lot of the smaller operators are tapping into the same solutions. As you mentioned, and Barry mentioned as well, orchestration is foundational. You know, it's not a differentiator anymore. Having intent driven orchestration across a multi-domain, multi-vendor environment is critical. And as part of that, that's where you really need an open, extensible orchestrator, and not one that locks customers in. It has to be one that customers are allowed to extend themselves. You know, they don't have to come back to Adtran to say, hey, we want to bring on such and such a vendor. Can you write us a plugin for this? No, they need to be able to do that themselves, or contract a third-party company, or come to us if they want to pay us to do it. You know, so that's kind of a key part of it. But where we are starting to see a lot of evolution now, applying the methods of, particularly of machine learning, onto the solutions that we have today, we've put a lot of focus on, for example, we talked earlier about the importance of fiber monitoring for securing the networks, etc. So we put a lot of focus on now applying machine learning to our fiber monitoring solutions that allow service providers to much more accurately pinpoint the devices that are on their network. And then they can leverage information coming from, let's say, the fiber access systems, the OLT systems, etc., to identify, you know, okay, this isn't just an event on a fiber trace, this is this particular piece of equipment which is deployed in that particular address on that fiber trace. So we can start to correlate a lot more information back together to give much deeper insights as to what, what the events are on my fiber network, where they're happening, and then I can use that then as a, I suppose, a gold standard fingerprint for each network segment. And when things start to deviate from that fingerprint, then I can take action very, very quickly. So applying all of those things, but ultimately feeding them all back into that one single pane of glass environment, so that, you know, when an alert comes in, somebody doesn't have to dive into six different systems to try and reverse engineer what's happening. Instead, they're getting a message on the screen there saying, customer A has poor connectivity because there's a microband at this part in the network. It's really dumbing the message down and giving it all on one system.
Perfect. Yeah, thanks, Ron. And just quickly from Sam and Justin before we'll go to questions. In terms of YouFibre and Omnia, what things are you thinking about here, especially around consolidation? You know, around how you know if one were to bring together multiple networks, what technologies are all underpinning that to enable that scaling efficiency?
Do you mean from an automation perspective? Sorry.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. From a perspective of really trying to drive the sales continuously on that consolidated network.
Yeah. So, as Ronan alluded to, the majority of the XGS PON-based LTs in the field are Adtran, as are ours. So, the orchestration across that should be relatively simple between companies. I'm sure many companies have done it in different ways. There's obviously the Adtran specific modules you can add on. We've built our own. But it's all based on open source, you know, Yang NetConf type models that you can go and look at and build yourself. So it shouldn't really matter too much what actual system underpins it. It should just be a case of they're all the same box, they have the same data models, they can be orchestrated in the same ways. So that's how we've done it. And then on the service provider network, it's radius based, and again you're looking at open platforms that many other people would have used to do something similar. So I think that should all be in place for us. Yeah.
Thanks. And just quickly, Justin, because of questions,
I guess three very quick ones for me. So I think around kind of the machine learning and AI, you know, as Ronan says, I think it's about kind of event correlation. So one of the things that we're working on at the moment is, as an example, you know, if we see ONT alarms in our Nokia infrastructure, what we're doing is some correlation on that to say, well, actually, if I see five ONTs that are on the same DP go down at the same time, or start to give low light alarms at the same time, then I can probably surmise that it's the distribution fiber to that DP has an issue. So if it's only one that's gone, or if it's five gone down and they're all on different DPs, it's probably single user faults. So I'll put them into a different priority in our work stack. So we're trying to do that. And, you know, fundamentally it's about saying, well, when we double our customer base, I don't want to be doubling the size of my ops team. So it's how do we get those efficiencies and economies of scale? Another example of one we're working on, our active cabinets. We started off with door sensors. So you got an alarm in the knock every time a door was opened. And they went, well, this is a bit of a faff. So then we put cameras inside. So when we got the door alarm, we could see who it was. And a human being could decide whether that mattered or not. And now what we're doing is facial recognition on those cameras. So when the door opens, the alarm goes off, the camera looks at it. If it's an engineer that we recognize and they have a change approval, then we'll ignore it. If it's not somebody we're expecting to be in that cabinet, then it generates an alarm in the NOC. So I think it's getting smart about how you do these things. So you're managing by exception, not every single event. And then the final one around consolidation, I mean, we're in sort of fairly early in our journey, but I mean, what we've tried to do in the investment we made in the IT systems is to put abstraction layers in. So for example, around provisioning, we use a platform called NetAdmin. So I could have integrated all of my CRM platforms directly into the element managers to provision broadband and voice. But what I actually do is I go via NetAdmin and acts as an abstraction layer. So if at any point in time somebody else needed to be provisioning in my network, they don't have to integrate with all my elements. They can come straight into NetAdmin and that will manage that orchestration. So we're just trying to simplify future integration by making some of these investments now.
Great, thank you. Thanks, Justin. Right, I think we've got time for maybe two questions. So if you're able just to introduce yourself beforehand.
Hi, thank you. Sorry, Andrew Company, 419 Consulting. To perhaps be a little bit provocative, at the moment the industry basically sells on price and technology which is fine for early adopters, is not going to drive the mass market. Do you think anyone's got the imagination and the competence to sort of actually sell something which will appeal to the mass market? Or are you basically going to be led to price-driven competition where networks are overbuilt and that's the only way you can get more market share? So who can actually build a B2C brand that's sustainable long-term?
Maybe if I can do a quick comment, and unfortunately I'm not going to comment on the UK market because I don't see as much of it here yet, but I think it'll come in time. But if I look at, for example, the more mature fiber market like the Spanish market, I think Telefonica has done an exceptional job of really building a very comprehensive bundle offering for consumers out there that really allows consumers to digitize their entire lifestyle, everything from Ring doorbells to, you know, monitored home security to you name it, you know, cloud backup, whatever. But the beauty with that bundle, it's pretty well documented within industry, the bundle complexity is directly related to your churn rate. So the more elements within a bundle, the lower the churn is, because it's harder for customers to switch out there. And at the last count that I looked at what Telefonica was doing there, I think they were up at a 6-play at that point in time, and they had more services that were being developed. So I think they're going in the direction that you're thinking of there. It's no longer just about the how many bits I can stuff down the pipe, it's about a lifestyle.
Sam, do you
want to
chip in?
Yeah, I think it's a valid criticism. One I alluded to in some of my answers around the network being the selling point, and that will have to change. You know, I think you have to build other elements onto that, customer service and how you treat the customer and how they experience your brand. But I agree that that is a very open question, I think, for the industry at the moment.
Can I just add on to that as well, that price does matter? So we work with a lot of ISPs globally, and price does matter to them. And what we've found as well, you don't have to sacrifice the quality of hardware. So from the data center side of the stuff, like, so say edge core design and build a 10 gig switch for Facebook. All the other OEMs out of Taiwan now design and build that same 10 gig switch, but they didn't have to put any R&D in it. So now that the price level is starting to come down, and if you standardize on certain hardware, so open hardware for the data center, obviously the price comes down, so everybody wins.
Hi, Helen Wild from Wildernet. I've got a question for you all. So in terms of futures, I think that the industry technically is leaving itself open to disintermediation, and that would reduce us to basically the value of nothing, because effectively there's quality is removed and given to the second layer. And I think the designs of the network right now are absolutely vital to future-proof them against that potential risk from people like Amazon in the very near future. In fact, we've looked at the technology and we think we're no more than 2 years away from that type of threat. The earlier debate was about customers and how they add value to your share price and the opportunities in the marketplace. What do you think are the best ways to guard against that disintermediation in order to make sure we safeguard the investment that we've put into our networks to safeguard the future of the UK networks and what we're providing in terms of Wi-Fi to the home and to businesses?
That's a really great question, Justin.
Oh gosh, I mean, it's a tricky one because it's a bit of an unstoppable machine, really, isn't it? If you look at Netflix and Amazon, I think what we've really been focused on is you know, providing a really good scalable platform that will enable those services ultimately. And then I think there will be an opportunity to kind of look at rebundling those back in. I guess the difficulty is if you look at, I mean, probably the best example is kind of Virgin Media. I mean, a lot of the feedback we get is that actually the big bundle people are increasingly disliking, and actually they want to take a Bitstream service and have a relationship with Netflix and have a relationship with Amazon Prime. But I think what's quite interesting is that disaggregation is actually going to an extreme where you've got multiple relationships with multiple providers. You've got Disney and you've got Paramount. So I think it will go through a cycle of people wanting to sign up to all of those services and then finding actually when they total up individually all of the packages that they've got across all these different suppliers, actually they're in a worse position than they were when they were taking a big bundle. So I think the pendulum will swing back again. And I think the smart play from providers like us will be finding a really good way to integrate those packages back into our platforms and bundle those up and have really good offerings around those. But at the moment, the tide is going in a slightly different direction. I think it's quite hard to stop that, but I think it will come back again.
I think in addition to what just covered there, the point he made earlier as well of that kind of, we describe it from a global vendor perspective, that global type mindset of, you know, you want broad coverage, but you really want to be well entrenched within the communities that you're working within so that you're building brand equity within those communities and they stay loyal to you as well. I think that's probably one of the best ways to protect from losing everything basically to, you know, sources coming in over the top of a dumb bib pipe.
Thanks everyone. I think that's all we've got time for, sadly, but many thanks to all the panelists today and for listening. Thank you.